Andrej.
Hello. Nice to see you here. Thanks. Nice to see you here during Saturday. I was coming to Riga several times for this type of events. I'm from Lithuania. And at the moment I work as a development manager in one company that works for, develops a platform for online advertising business. And I just, the goal of this presentation, I just want to share my experience, my ideas about learning in my company and what we are trying to do. And the idea is to try to apply the Scrum knowledge to the organizational design, because I became a development manager and I just have to do something, yeah? So, but before that, I want to share my points of view on management and actually what inspires me to do this change in my company. Basically, I think that all our problems started with scientific management, if you know what it is. And scientific management is a scary thing, which was invented by this person. Well, it's a scary thing now, but invented by this person, Frederick Taylor, who actually was very fond of making everything efficient. He was working as a mechanical engineer at that time, and he just really noticed that people who work on factories, they are inefficient, and he saw that things could get better. So what he did such thing, he introduced a couple of principles and rules that he started to apply in his work. And this is what he did. He said that, for example, all the decisions that we decide, we can do this or that, can be changed with scientific methods, and they can be explained and foreseen and so on. Also he said that scientifically we can, it's like referring to the performance appraisals, we can scientifically select people and then just decide what they can do, evaluate their skills, like the skill of development +5, the skill of working -10. And he divided work and introduced the detailed instructions. This is actually what we have in our daily work. At that time, it was really a revolution, because it increased efficiency so much that all the industry age is like was a boom at that time. But he did one very scary thing, actually. He separated thinking from doing, as you saw this at point number 3. And this is what we have now, actually. And this separation led to a very simple thing that we have now. That there are managers or top managers or whatever who actually perform all the thinking. And there are stupid workers that actually they just to perform, they need it at work just to do the stuff. You do that, you develop this application, you go there and so on and so on. And well, you know the structure of your company, yes? We have a similar one, actually. But for some reasons it worked, yes? And I was thinking, okay, if it was revolutionary, everybody liked that, why did it work? And I think these are the reasons, because actually the context of that time, it was completely different. There were monopolies, the business was slow. As previous guy mentioned, that the people were actually taken from the field, they were not educated, there were no laptops and information flow, and they had those instructions, had to have instructions, because they were not capable of doing the work. But we just know that we're a bit 100 years ahead, yes? Everything has changed now. So, but we're still applying those things. And the funny thing that after Frederick Taylor, there were some other very smart people who introduced other ideas, and they were explaining why this is bad and why we need to stop thinking doing that. One of those guys was Peter Drucker. Actually, he's the first one. It was in the 50s or 60s, I don't remember. He introduced this term knowledge worker that we use now. And he was also introducing the thing that we need to work in organizations by by objectives. Like, we set objectives and we try to achieve them, and this is how we need to manage people. There was another guy, Douglas McGregor, who this introduced famous theory of X and Y. It's like, do you know this? Are you familiar with this theory? No, yes? Okay, if there is no, then I will explain a bit. That theory X states that that people need motivation, they are lazy, they don't want to do work, and that's why we need managers for that. And theory Y tells that people are motivated by themselves and they just want to do stuff. It's just they needed to put into right environment. And what he proves that there is no people of theory X, actually. So this is the thing. And that's why he's saying that we need to put people into right environment. And that's why a previous speaker was telling that when person is not performing, you can change the team, for example, or you can change the work, or you can change something else, but not the person itself. Another guy, Deming, I think he is a bit overused today. I mean, there are a lot of referrals, but the most valuable thing out of his work is that the manager is the guy who oversees, like he sees the system outside. That's why he can improve that and change the system, but not the people. But sometimes managers fall back, like those scientific managers, they try to change people. They see, skills improve, go, we will be better. Another guy, you know this one also, Teichi Oho, he's like a founder of this Lean system, Toyota Lean system. And his famous saying is, which is completely against the Taylor, is that people come to work to think, not to work. And especially in our industry, I think. And this another guy, we spent a lot of time with him, Niels, he talks a lot about network organizations and value organizations. And actually, by him I was inspired recently. And yes, this structure and all the performance appraisals and this kind of stuff, they create fear. They don't help to build better things. So why do we still using this? And I have such opinion that scientific management is like smoking. For example, for me it took 3 attempts to quit smoking. So maybe everybody has to try several times in order to avoid this bad habit. Because I don't have any other explanation why we're doing this. Or maybe it's because we go to universities and basically everybody teaches us to draw the hierarchy and so on and so on. And we just do that out of the habit. And then I had another question in my head. Can it work at all for these kind of companies like startups or those who are working on products or projects or in software industry? And basically, I think that no. If I would be building a company from scratch, I would be doing it differently today with all the knowledge. So let's get back to Scrum. What actually, do you remember project working according waterfall? How it looks? It looks like that, yes? So very, very similar to what Frederick Taylor suggests. There is a smart project manager or whatever. All the if it's a bigger project, then we have a team of analysts, we have team of QA engineers, we have team of developers, and everybody is extremely busy, working, and produce crap because we are late and so on and so on. Okay, what happened? Yeah, Scrum to the rescue. Here is the Scrum, and basically, we also started to apply it. It's very difficult to apply because it's very loosely defined and there are a lot of things that depend on context. But it helps a lot. It really helps, and I think these are the main things why Scrum works. It's because, first of all, for me at least, it's because of the cross-functional teams, because you really have a team that can deliver. It's not like analysts produce documents, someone produce something else. And the teams are most often built around the value creation, and they really deliver. Okay, so it works. If you didn't try Scrum, try it. Definitely will help you. So, but let's get back to organizational design. When I joined the company I'm working in, we were around 35 people. It's including client support, including sales and top management. And now we are around 300, I think. So, and the things changed a lot. That time we started to apply Scrum because our process was a bit chaotic and this was the problem, and we applied that. But afterwards we started to grow, and we fall back to the habit that we learned from the schools, from the tailor and so on and so on. And what we started to do, as it's a bad habit, we started to form around the functions. Of course, we are taught about that everywhere. So what we started to have: product department, development department, sales department. It's like, does it remind you about the project? For me, it does. And the thing is that the groups and the teams are starting to be built around the function, not the value. So just like in the project. And so another thing that's to be bad, when there is a group of people formed around the function, what they start to do? They need to do something, like analysts. They need to write a lot of documents because they need to prove their existence to the company. The same happens with the whole departments, like the sales department, the development department. We start to build different kind of KPIs and so on. And one of the examples is with the IT team, yes, which was even the functional department also to like 1 year ago or 2 years ago. And what was happening is that feature teams that actually deliver value and earn money were dependent on how IT buys hardware. And for example, delays like, and there were very simple reason, because the manager that we need to be efficient and we need to get the best price for the hardware. And of course, if you buy with batches, you get the better price. But teams need software, so they, or hardware, so they started to buy ahead. So actually, the company in itself was spending maybe even more. So it's stupid, doesn't it? Another thing that happened: everything started to feel slow. It's like with the project. Everybody is busy, everybody is doing a lot of stuff, but feeling is bad. And for me, it's like just completely the same as with the project. Okay, these are the problems, so what are the alternatives? I spend a lot of time reading and trying to analyze and what to do, and the alternatives are of these network organizations. Like the whole organization actually need to be built about, you know, so it's like a network of value creation teams. I tried to make a sketch of what it could be, because we're really on the early phase of doing this. So it's just an idea. So I don't have all the answers, but the concept itself. So we need to organize ourselves around the value creation, not about the function, like in the project. What before going to the challenges, there are ideas, like idea how to organize around the value creation. Let's introduce not the functional departments, but some other departments. Like value department is a Scrum team that is cross-functional and cross-functional and does all this stuff and then can provide the value. And all the helping departments, I will describe what is that. It would be like a Scrum Master. And you know that the good Scrum Master is not the one who comes and tells what to do. It's more like a serving object or a serving person who helps when he's asked, but not vice versa. So what could it be, this value department? I think it could be defined like value department has to have a leader. It's either product or technical leader, whatever, but who tells what to do. It's like a product owner. Then it's cross-functional. It has all the sales, client support, guys, whatever is needed, maybe DevOps even. And he just does the stuff. Like he knows, this value department knows his clients. And these clients could be either external or internal. Because the company, for example, our company is quite a big one. And also, like, to help this thinking, this value department can be also described like a startup that delivers something from A to Z. And how to build this value department? Well, for example, these principles, what do you think about them? It couldn't be too big. It could be like around 40 people. Let's take it 35. And from my experience, this is the really enough number of people for a group that can earn a lot of money. For example, WhatsApp was sold for a huge amount of money, and they are something around 50, I think. Another thing that this leader must be entrepreneurial type. It's not the type of a person who sits and waits, okay, tell me what to do, what's the vision, I will do the rest. He must be the seeker. And of course, they must have clear understanding and description of services. What do they provide, what do they do, and what useful things they actually make. And another what's important, because in companies what happens, because for example, in a rare company, you can use some external IT services or to do the external billing or to do whatever externally. There are policies that you're not allowed to do this and so on, because someone made that decision. But here, I think it shouldn't be forbidden. It just should be given as an opportunity. And you use those services which are better by the price, by the delivery, by the quality. And in this way, this functional department will never be used, for example. And what does it mean? He needs to be killed. How to evaluate them? Because I think it's the very trivial answer to this question. Because, well, it's easy. You earn money, you have users, or investments are going to pay off. That's okay. Yeah, you are a valid department. You are useful, so we keep you. What about the helping department? I think these departments should be as small as possible, and all non-value creating functions needs to be there. And they for the value departments, these ones should be optional. Because why do you need to use company IT services if they are more expensive and slower? Go to some company which can provide you something much better. And you will not have any problems with people motivation, blah, 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 blah. You get what you need. But maybe it's too drastic, I don't know. Okay, so what are the challenges? Because we started this discussion, we are thinking how to do it. But of course there are a lot of challenges. And at least for me, one of the biggest challenges to hire right people to these type of organizations, because based on our education system and our habits, you will get people into a company that are used to get the instructions and used to old way of thinking. So this will be even more difficult to solve, because I don't know how it's in Latvia, but in Lithuania it's almost impossible to find a developer, good developer, or a good product manager. Another thing, like what I already mentioned, is just to change the mindset of the people. And even in our company, it's like you simply fall into this this mood of trying to control that. And you especially see this in such in IT teams or in teams which have some unique knowledge. They try to control stuff rather than to give away or to provide a service for others, use them. So it's a very difficult task from my point of view. Another thing, maybe it's very related to our company, is technical excellence or technical agility, as they call it. Because what I also, from my experience, noticed that we fall into a situation that we form teams or even the departments around the technical components rather than value creation. But reasoning for that is that, well, but it's easier because they know the stuff, they just, I don't know, let them do IT or let them do some core data processing, as in ours. And there is no API services, but I will get back to solutions, how we see them, what we're doing now. So I think, but in general, this technical excellence allows you to change organization as you like, I think. Another problem is how to define the value departments. For us, we started to think a bit how it could be done. It's not so easy at all, because we have a lot of interdependencies of the product, a lot of things sell together. So for us, it will be a very long journey. And I don't know the answers yet so far. The last challenge, from my point of view, is transparency. Because by transparency, I mean not only the financial numbers or something related to other numbers like KPIs, how we're doing and how many users there are, which is also quite difficult to do. But by transparency, I mean understanding of the domain and understanding of the founders of how our founders make the decisions and how they do business. It's like this thinking, because when you're getting further and further from the ones who are closest to the clients, it's difficult for the developers or product managers who recently, for example, joined the company. They don't know how things are done, and they like wait for some decisions, create non-existing rules, and so on and so on. So it's difficult to solve that. Okay, but I told you all the problems, I told you the hypothesis, but now what? I can tell you what we are doing. First, it's like we're trying to solve this technical excellence thing. And we're trying to do it in a way that we want to build a lot of services that allow our company to be more flexible and not depending on the technical stuff. Another thing, we identified one cross-functional, we call it pod. I don't remember the reason, but who cares? The main thing is that we build it out of, now it's 12 people out of different departments, and they work as one single Scrum team on every day. And the funny thing to notice that the motivation results, they actually dramatically increased. It was in the same way when similar result when we applied Scrum long time ago. And another funny thing is that when client support people and sales people are far away, and plus we have a complex product where people get lost in all the communication around, when they started to work together, they actually changed the backlog completely. Although the one thing, the development team for this pod didn't change. It was the same development team. The thing is that we just joined all the rest of the company to them. And the backlog changed dramatically. So they understood the client needs and they found the workarounds how to deliver faster. And so basically we treat it as a success. And it's like for us, it's a proof to find further such cross-functional groups or departments and continue with this way. What we don't know is like how, like, now it's, we can say it, it's a bit virtual, but we don't know if to make it an organization, yes, and should it all organization to be like that. So we will be talking about this a lot. And another thing, referring to those helping departments, I'm working a lot with IT team, and from my point of view, they are control freaks. They don't give any access or whatever to developers, although there is a lot of dependencies there. And what we try, what we're trying to do is to build a private cloud so developers can start using all the servers when they need in the same way as the Amazon. And what I also want to do them, so they would, so our IT department would be competing with Amazon by according to these services. And everybody can use external services instead of them. And we'll see how it ends. Also, we started to work around Kanban because we were not doing it properly recently, and it resulted in the changes in our team. But in general, things I see how they get better, because when those helping departments start to feel that they will have a competition, it's very good motivation for everybody. And plus, it changed the developers thinking also, because I can use that, I can use that. So giving the alternatives also helps. Behind the scenes, so it's more about the results and actual things that happened, but behind the scenes, it was happening around year and a half, maybe more, like including the reading a lot about this stuff. We had two workshops with all the product managers and Scrum Masters around this network organizations. It was like full day event discussing the problems and possible problems and existing problems. And also, like, during this time, we managed to get the full support of the top management, if you call it. So there is no doubt that we want to go that way. The question is how we will go it and what will be the actual result. And the funny thing, how we initiated, how this pot was kicked off, we have such thing as conferences inside the company. So it wasn't even the some of the managers who said, let's try to do that. But it was one of the product managers who has very strong business and technical knowledge. He actually suggested, let's try to do that. Let's stop talking. So we were talking so long about this that he decided, no, we need to do this. We need to try it. And he actually kicked off that, not the management even. So it's also the good stuff. What's next? How we're going to move on with these ideas? We're definitely not going to try it in a big bang. The reason for that is very simple. We can't risk the money and investments that we're getting. So we need to keep the business, but we will be keep looking for the next pots, as we call them, and we will be doing more and more of this, and definitely we will learn something. The next thing, I want to keep this principle in place and make it extremely difficult and veto as much as possible any kind of managerial positions that this will also force us to find other ways how to do it, and instead to look for technical people and technical talents who actually do this stuff. So just not to grow this ratio between non-value creation and value creation. Because in my opinion, a manager, he doesn't create value, but he can help to create the value. He can build the right environment around this. And I hope we are lucky. Thank you.